Thank you so much, Rosemary. And I will start off by just saying thank you for having us on this panel, and also giving thanks to the distinguished members of this panel, like Gio Chicas, and the work that Latoya is doing. We're privileged to share the stage with you all. So, like Rosemary mentioned, my name is Reina Kamau. And I'm one of the co-founders for Black Girls Map alongside Whitney. And I think I'll give Whitney some time to introduce herself before we get started with the introduction.
Thanks, Reina. Hi, everyone. Rosemary, sorry for not giving you my bio. I'm a program lead, design program lead at Esri, particularly working on user experiences for all of the products, whether it be desktop to web to mobile. And then obviously that's the day job. At night, Reina and I are doing Black Girls Map work, where we are particularly interested in just trying to map key issues that are impacting marginalized communities, also uplifting the Black community and bringing awareness to issues that are primarily targeted to Black members. And then also we've kind of ventured into the election. So we'll talk a little bit more about that in our talk, but obviously voting is an important topic right now for us. So go ahead, Rania.
Yeah. So just to give you all an introduction of how we got started, Whitney and I work together. And one observation that we had was that there was not a lot of representation within the GIS space or in the GIS field. There were not a lot of Black women. And we would ask ourselves oftentimes, where's the rest of us? And when we started looking at the research, I won't go too much into the research here, but it was quite evident that there was a gap and there was a disparity, especially amongst Black women in the field of GIS, and even coming to know more is even in the STEM field. So with that knowledge and with that kind of I would not call it an epiphany, but with having that truth, we started asking ourselves, what can we do? And that actually is what spun up Black Girls Map, because we wanted to, number one, find out where are the Black women in the field of GIS. We wanted to celebrate them. We wanted to know where they were. We wanted to be able to connect with each other to know that, hey, there's another Black woman in this field, and that we're not alone. That's how we got started. We got started by wanting to celebrate women, and particularly Black women in the field of GIS. So when we started, and this was about a year and a half ago, 2018, that was our primary objective. But we found out with our skills that we could put our GIS skills and our GIS knowledge into evangelizing GIS, because the common denominator between Whitney and I and several other women that we interviewed or we connected with was the fact that we stumbled upon GIS. We did not know what GIS was, and that was the common narrative. So we started asking ourselves, how can we make GIS not a coincidence, but more of an intention? How can we vocalize or evangelize GIS in our community? And that's when we started saying, or we got into our GIS projects. So the first GIS project that we actually spun up was Black Women in GIS. And like I said, we wanted to know where each, you know, where these women were. We came up with this application that we put together with a web app builder. That's an Esri application that we were able to customize, or just to kind of tweak it a little to be able to understand how many women were, right? We wanted to understand where they were. So this was our first project. We were able to see, you know, here's the Black women and here's where they are. And not only that, like when we pushed this out as our first project, we got tons of feedback and tons of LinkedIn requests from other Black women wanting to be showcased or wanting to be included in this map. So this map is a living directory where we're still collecting bios and information about Black women. Another project that we got involved with is the California Black Businesses. And this is an application we put together, especially with the climate of our society or of our country right now. There was a lot of conviction from various people groups of wanting to support Black businesses. So this is an application. We actually did this after the Black women in GIS, but this application was primarily tailored to California. But the team is our team is actually working on templatizing this and pushing out a resource that can be able to get this application out to different states. And another another project that we always talk about when we do most of our talks is we started visualizing the police brutality and the issues with law enforcement and the Black community way before. So this is a project we started working on in October, actually a year ago, and this was going into the class of preventable shootings where we used data. We had to we wanted to take our views out of it, and we wanted to use data, just like Selena was talking about, for us to tell that story. Sometimes we would get that challenge of data not being equitable, but we were able to get some data that was able that we were able to tell this to tell the story of the Black community being disproportionately affected with the shootings or with violence from law enforcement. So we went into that, and this is another this will lead me to our next project where I'm going to let Whitney speak more about. But having done this last year, with everything that happened early this year with the protests and the George Floyd situation, we started asking ourselves, what more can we do? We've visualized it, but what is there else that we can do that's actionable? Because Black Girls Map, the map within our initial stands for Mapping with Action to Pioneer Progress. So, and all these projects are on our website. Feel free to go in there. We'll provide the our website information after the presentation, but we pretty much just let the data speak for itself. And we were able to tell patterns that were kind of collected from this research. So we have tons of other projects we got involved in. Like I said, we have, especially with the COVID happening, we started researching to take a look at how exactly COVID is affecting the Black community. And I think it's it might not be common knowledge, but the Black community is being affected disproportionately, you know, with COVID. And this is due to other factors such as underlying health issues that they might be having. Sometimes it's the living conditions of where they are. But that's another project that feel free to go take a look at. And the reason why I'm skimming through these projects is because I want to give some time and space for Whitney to go into the People for the People project, because this is our most current project. And with the state of the country right now, I think you'll be kind of justified to have more time to talk about that. So as I wrap up here, we have all these projects on our website, and that's bgmap.org. We have a hate application. We have the state of immigration of the U.S., and that's a dashboard that we put together. But we have all these, most of our projects kind of consolidated within this application, within our website. So with that, I'll push it over to Whitney so she can talk about People for the People, an initiative that spun up from the question I talked about earlier, which was, we see these things happening in our community. What can we do about it? So go ahead, Whitney, whenever you're ready. I'll stop sharing my screen.
Thanks, Raina. Great job. Let me go ahead and share my screen. So to Raina's point around our new venture into politics, I will jump into what that initiative is. So just to give you guys some context, after the recent events of not even just the pandemic itself, but George Floyd specifically, the protests, Raina and I asked ourselves, how can Black Girls Map get involved? We also felt a sense of conviction, which was, we saw someone having harm done to themselves, and nothing that we, like as a society, could do anything about it. But we knew that there are policies, there's history, there's generational things that led to that event, and we took it very personally. So Raina and I realized that there's a conviction that we also play a role in what happened that day. And in these recent occurrence of things that have happened specifically to members in our community,
we play a role, which is we need to get more invested, more involved in how policies are written, how these laws are created, and to create more, I guess, spaces for protection, specifically for marginalized communities, not just in the context of law enforcement, but in other areas where there's disparities, you know, where it's health, education. And so, you know, so that's where we kind of ended up, I think. And we realized that we had to do more. Now, Raina and I, we have a small team. Black Girls Map is a small team of members who just want to map with action, and we have fun with that. But definitely we knew that we were taking on more than we could actually handle, because both Raina and I also have not really been up until this point personal about politics. So we had some learning to do as well, and realized that we needed a larger group of people to help us with this effort. So P4TP was birthed out of Black Girls Map. It's a GIS community focused on educating and empowering community members to engage with civic issues. What we are today from, you know, 3-4 months ago when Ray and I had this conversation, is we're a group of 150 plus individuals who rallied together in June of 2020. People were GIS nerds, some of us were cartographers and developers, designers, and some of us were just community members. And a lot of it was just us wanting to do something. We have a passion for change and unity, which we really need right now, as there's lots of division throughout this nation. So that was our protest. Our protest wasn't anything to go left or right. We are in neutral ground as best as we can to just promote for all things unified. As I said, our motivation was really around the recent events that took place along with the pandemic. But our goals are really just to pledge to share information as best as we can in that neutral territory, educate community members on why voting is important. Because as we see these things that we might disagree with or that we might not like that's happening, you know, education, that awareness about what's going on is key to know how you can get involved. And then the next step to that is once you understand how to get involved, you got to go do it. So, you know, our main primary action is to collaborate and promote projects that visualize what's going on in these communities and our communities, and start to shape, to show how they shape the political landscape. And in that, we're highlighting major issues. We still are not forgetting about how we started, which was the Black community primarily, and looking at other marginalized communities. And so we've done it. And I'm gonna jump over to how we've done it. We didn't know if we were gonna be able to pull it off, but our team, we had an amazing team of people that came together volunteering their time. These are people who have day-to-day jobs in COVID, they have children, and other things going on, families, and they got this done. So we are so grateful to everyone who was involved with this project. But essentially, we asked the question, who are you voting for? And we had to ask ourselves this as we were trying to figure out how we would approach this initiative. And essentially, what we realized is that we have to get personal about that question, right? It's not about a particular candidate. It's not about a particular party affiliation. It's about the people at the end of all of this, right? Who's getting impacted? You know, when I start talking about immigration, who's in the detention centers? Who's being impacted, right? And so we went down this journey. We created an entire resource for people now, for community members to go to this free of charge. You can go, academics, students, community members, government officials, corporations can come here and find out more about how they can get involved, when the deadlines are, who's running for their state, and key issues. One of the key things that we wanted to highlight is that we break down in one story map, the electoral process, the whole entire thing from start to finish, why it was created, why it's important. We even go into creating applications where you can see the voting rights by state. So you can go in here and filter and see, you know, what is the age, you know, if you're incarcerated, what states allow for you to vote. For homeless people who don't have identification, they can find out which states require photo IDs. We also have another application in that who can vote around just the voter information. So you can find out for your state, I'm picking California because Rand and I are in California, but you know, you can find out what's your state's election site, what's the voter registration deadlines, the absentee mail-in registration deadlines, and, you know, the rules around that as well. These are all information that span across like several different resources. We put it all in one place for people just to make it easy for people to be able to vote. We also dive into key voting issues. These are the issues that even if it doesn't impact you directly, it's probably impacting your community. It's probably impacting you one way or another indirectly because you are still part of that community. One particular project, as you guys can go through this list, if you go to peopleforthepeople.org, and I'll make sure to give you guys the site as well. But if you guys go into that, you can actually check out gender equity. And in that, we did an amazing collaboration with an ESRI ERG, Employee Resource Group, We Can, and also North Star, which is another employee resource group at ESRI. So we did a collaboration where we actually mapped out the entire historic evolution of women's right to vote in a cool story map collection. In that, you can also find out information that we've mapped, which is simply just women suffrage activists in the U.S. As it pertains to both in the past and the present. We've also done some really cool innovations through our People for the People initiative with this collaboration called sentiment mapping. So we're the first to introduce this, which we're proud to say, but essentially we're using a combination of Experience Builder, some APIs, JavaScript API, along with Survey123 to make all of this work. But essentially it is a word cloud that is also a map of sentiments around the nation. So you can pose any question. In this particular example, it's all around gender equity. We've done one around racial around the whole race relations in the US, but essentially community members can come here, add their feelings. It will tag their word, but also provide the context as to why they chose that word. And we really feel like this is a powerful way to use language and tone to talk about very important topics that are happening to us and to try to get a gauge as to how people are really feeling versus what the news is saying and, you know, what you see from the news. So it's a really cool way, I guess, of engagement there. And then the last...
I'm sorry, I have to cut you off. We're just a little bit behind time. So, and I can tell, man, this is so amazing. And I know you guys could probably talk about all these resources forever. I'm super impressed that this is things that you guys are doing on the side of your day job. Again, thank you so much. I'm sorry we couldn't go over everything, but luckily you can interact with people in the Slack channel afterwards. And I know you'll have, I think, a lot more people in that People for People community after this inspiring talk. So thank you both.
Thank you guys.
Raina and Whitney. I hope you can stick around and chat with some people.
Yeah, thank you. Awesome. Thank you guys.
Okay. Thank you to everyone also on the live stream. I know we are running a little behind, but I think everyone can understand these are some really amazing talks. So.